record based on tracking assistant tracker, the criminal cyber response, and services branch of the FBI. Such a way the FBI might identify if you've worked in five FBI field divisions working on the comprehensive attack on a SWAT team. If so, you're a special agent in charge of the secondary field office and assistant tracker in charge of the Washington field office, the FBI's second largest office. This composition oversees criminal investigative division, cyber division, office of international operations, office of law enforcement coordination, and the critical incident response group. The second largest would be Lawrence Rosenberg, who is deputy assistant attorney general of the Department of Justice's office on legal policy, where his responsibilities include helping develop the department's legal policy regarding child exploitation and obscenity, violence against women, trafficking of persons, among other issues. Next line is Ms. Rusher, I think, from Rose, CEO for the Law and Internet Rights Against Children Task Force, and a developer of a task force, and a network. His work has led to the arrest of hundreds of internet sex offenders around the world. Next line is Sharon Collins, director of Exploited Children at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Among her responsibilities, she's directly oversees the nation's cyber tip line, and congressionally mandated recipient of reports on child exploitation by the public and all U.S.-based electronic service providers. She's published numerous articles on child exploitation, sex and exploitation, and has helped coordinate 25 international law enforcement agencies for Operation Upsmith, a worldwide child pornography study conducted by the New Jersey Division of Criminal Justice. Next witness will be Greer Weeks, the executive director of the National Association to Protect Children, a nonpartisan organization with members in 50 states. In 2002, Mr. Weeks was instrumental in bringing together national experts on child protection with political veterans to form, protect, and co-child anti-crime lobby focused exclusively on child protection. Since 2002, Protect has worked with 8 dozen state legislatures and nationally in stronger child protection laws. And next, we'll hear from John Ryan, Chief Counsel for America Ryan, Incorporated. He is the Compliance and Investigations Department, where he's responsible for the development and implementation of policies and processes to combat illegal activities on ALM services. He serves as a liaison with the law enforcement, to coordinate investigations and prosecutions of criminal activities, including offenses against minors, and serves as a board member of the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Our last witness will be Elizabeth Becker, Vice President and Associate Advocate, Counsel for Compliance at Yahoo Incorporated. She manages the global law enforcement compliance function and her team advises the company on child protection, information security, and related compliance issues. She's on the board of directors of the U.S. Internet Service Providers Association. She recently served in the Virginia Attorney General's Youth Internet Safety Task Force. So we'll begin with Mr. Mason.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. I'm the member for Marks and members of the committee. I would like to thank you for the opportunity to discuss the FBI's role in combating the sexual exploitation of children through the use of the internet. With more than 1 billion people around the world, with 2 billion online, the internet has become an integral part of our daily lives. It has dramatically enhanced the way we communicate, the way we live, and the way we work. Today, I want to talk about what the FBI is doing to attack child exploitation on the internet. I want to briefly touch on the scope of our efforts and the role of parents in the private sector, planning and addressing this problem. One of our most important programs is the Innocent Images National Initiative, which for the past 11 years has targeted sexual predators and used the internet to exploit children. Between 1996 and 2009, there were over 15,500 investigations opened in this program. During this 2-year period, the efforts of the Innocent Images National Initiative have resulted in the conviction of over 4,800 child predators. Facing increasing scrutiny, child predators are going further into crime, using file sharing networks, encrypted websites, concealing their financial transactions to advance online payment services, and traveling to foreign countries to exploit minors. In pursuit of these criminals, we currently have over 42 ongoing undercover operations across the country, with more than 240 agents investigating cases with their state and local counterparts. The FBI also works with officers and agents from Great Britain, Australia, Belarus, Thailand, and the Philippines, among other countries, identifying child criminals is only part of the equation. We must also collect the evidence necessary to convict them. Child predation is a global threat that requires a global response. We have trained more than 16,000 law enforcement officers to handle digital forensic evidence using a variety of tools, and an addition of 4,600 online using the special tool known as the image scan. This program enables investigators to identify, isolate, and store images from a suspect's computer onto a thumb drive. This year, we will conduct training with our international partners as well. The value of evidence confinement and our digital evidence forensic examiners is staggering. To address this ever-increasing challenge, the FBI has deployed 25 state-of-the-art forensic networks to major FBI field offices, with 10 additional offices scheduled to receive this equipment in 2009. These networks enable the FBI forensic examiners to more effectively place and seize digital evidence for review by investigators on their desktop computers. Also in 2008, the FBI plans to establish the first computer forensic unit dedicated solely to the processing of innocent images evidence. Part of our goal, and an integral part of the project Safe Child Act, is to educate the public about child exploitation. Again, we see a webcam as an easy and inexpensive way for a child to communicate with friends or relatives, but a predator sees it as an open window into a child's bedroom. In field offices around the country, agents are teaching parents the variety of tactics used by predators. We are also working with the Indian Nations of our Endangered Child Abuse Program, conducted in partnership with the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, and the Endangered Child Exploitation and Obscenity Section. Uses national and international media exposure to identify unknown predators and victims. Since 2004, publicity on the FBI website and two national television channels have resulted in the arrest of approximately 17 predators and the identification of more than 30 child victims. We have also enlisted the help of our private sector partners. We have asked internet service providers and search engine operators to monitor their websites for child pornography and to alert us when they discover illegal content. We are working with internet service providers seeking assistance in the retention of records of online activities monitoring, so that when we identify predators and their activities, the legal process will be effective to gather the necessary records in order to pursue successful prosecution. In closing, I want to recognize those who investigate and prosecute these cases. They deserve our respect and our admiration and our gratitude. They have seen the darkest side of humanity and continue to press on, as this is among the most important work we do. I would like to thank the committee for addressing this very important issue and for allowing me to testify, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Madison. I forgot to advise people about the events before you and find your works for 5 minutes, but Mr. Madison apparently didn't have any connections. So I thank you for your testimony. So, Mr. Madison. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Mr. Madison. Thank you for inviting me to represent the Department of Justice at this important hearing and to spread our court proposals for the answer I believe to investigate and prosecute predators who sexually exploit children, especially during the hearing. The findings of child exploitation is a priority for our department, as exemplified by our work in Project Safe Childhood, the nationally coordinating investigative and prosecutorial pornography issue, linking U.S. attorneys' offices across the country with federal, state, and local law enforcement, and organizations like the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. The Department appreciates Congress's strong support for these efforts, and the work they have done recently was broadly recognized in the Animal Child Protection and Safety Act of 2006 as our main efforts. I also wanted to fill in the statement that in the record we just summarize our principal proposals. Three of these proposals are contained in the final crime and anti-terrorism act in response to the Commission on Consumers this past May. We also have several new proposals to facilitate the prosecution of fugitive sex offenders. A number of these proposals will be familiar to you from Congressman Westrand's testimony earlier today, and I'll provide the Department's perspective on them. First, we request that Congress establish a mandatory minimum sentence for possession of child pornography. This is crucial because too many people believe that child pornography is just pictures and not a big deal. That's why, Mr. Chairman, each child pornography image is a visual record of the sexual exploitation of a child, instead of just a picture. And every time you scan the child, it's violating the game. Furthermore, it is the demand for such images that fuels the physical violation of the child in the first place. Unfortunately, since the federal sentencing guidelines became advisory, the number of downward approaches by judges in child pornography possession cases has led to
such departures. Establishment 2 now allows adults who are warning to potential consumers of child pornography provide unwarranted data departures forcefully expressed in our society's reversal of the self and child. Our second proposal would allow the court law provided by the Internet Service Provider not only left in the past to report the presence of child pornography, which was on its computer services, was subject to a criminal fine. This provision would be virtually impossible to enforce. Our legislation would therefore add a civil penalty that would be easier to enforce for negligent failure to report such images. These images are out there on somebody's computer server, and law enforcement needs to know that they can investigate and prosecute the crimes. A third proposal to close a gap in existing law that has led some courts to overturn convictions of possessors of child pornography. Some courts have narrowly interpreted it incorrectly in our view. The definition of possession, the term possession in the federal criminal code, so that a person who, for example, viewed images of child pornography on his computer and did not save them onto his disk drive, would not have violated the statute. Our proposal would amend the statute explicitly to cover knowingly accessing child pornography with the intent to view it. Our final set of proposals relates to 18 U.S.C. Section 2250, creating the Sex Offender Registration and Notification Act, SORNA, out of the Act of Washington. Section 2250 creates the federal felony offense of failing to register as a sex offender or to update the registration. By terms of the statute, it applies to a person who travels in interstate or foreign commerce. Since the law has been enacted, one federal district court has found that the statute's use in the present case travels means that the law only applies when an interstate or foreign travel occurred after the statute enactment. In order to clarify that this jurisdictional requirement is satisfied, regardless of whether the travel occurred before or after the enactment of the Overwatch Act, the statute should be limited to that past travel. Additionally, our proposal would clarify that Section 2250 offenses are continuing offenses as long as the offender's failure to register or update the registration exists. This clarification would eliminate the possibility of a claim by an offender that Section 2250 was an ex post facto law. Finally, as an enhancement of the criminal law, we propose to include Section 2250 in the child infraction of felony sex offenses that can be prosecuted at any time without limitation. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to discuss our proposals. I'm happy to answer your questions. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on this matter. I'm Flint Water, Special Agent with the Law Enforcement Criminal Investigation. I'm not here to testify on behalf of the Inquiring Eye Crimes Against Children Network. No one else who can do that appears to be from my work on the front lines investigating these cases and building the accurate data network. Let me share with you some of the material we see every day. Imagine moving the floor and drug being sodomized on the bed as your attacker tries to force him to comply with his wishes. If I'm a speaker, you can hear her screams of no, no, no. This child is trying to free herself unsuccessfully from this attacker. We've got movie of the toddler and changing to video film fantasy diaper from milk, and her Indian adult male penetrates the child. From the video, it is obvious that this is frequent activity for this little girl. In many of these videos, the offender films as they sneak into the child's bedroom with the lights from the camera. We can only imagine that the child's mother must be asleep unaware of somewhere else in the house. In a recent case, an offender filmed himself grabbing the juice boxes of neighboring children before tricking them into drinking the mix. He then filmed himself as he sexually abused unconscious children. Through the introduction of his training in child pornography, investigators found numerous local victims. When you do this sort of work, the strong pictures you just can't get out of your mind. For me, one is the picture of a young girl about 6 or 7. She's a man. She's strapped to a chair and the chair is falling over. And this child is being sexually assaulted by a dog. The tears are streaming up this little girl's face, and to my knowledge, she's not been identified. In one case, investigator and law, their offender was so fixated on manufacturing his child's sexual abuse images that he arranged to abduct two girls, not the East Coast, and one in Wyoming. When it came to Wyoming, he was arrested. During his interview after his arrest, he talked about plans to make his fortune selling child pornography. When asked about his intentions with the Wyoming Army, he said he was going to use her to make movies, and then sell her and leave her in the mountains to quote, she wouldn't survive. Recently, our investigators have been using systems to find individuals trafficking using peer-to-peer file sharing, searching for suggested images when the victims are especially young, and they are reported online, trading these images at that moment. In one day, recent case in the Western United States where the operations of a family found to be treating child sexual abuse images on the program networks. When he was identified by the enforcement family, he was arrested to a therapist at a children's hospital. He admitted targeting was meant the unconscious children who went down in hospice care. When asked how many children had left the house, he looked down at the father's son and asked how many his son had left. Child Connors members of the committee, the bad news is a worldwide task force. And the ICANN network can tell you how to get tens of thousands of sexual predators to monitor. The vast majority of these leads will never be investigated. In fact, less than 2% of these crimes we know about are investigated due to the sheer lack of resources. Most of the victims want to be rescued. We've already been to testify about what many of our law enforcement colleagues are not afraid to come out and tell you. We are overwhelmed. We are underfunded. And we are drowning in the title of a tragedy. We don't have the resources we need to save these children. Law enforcement's efforts to include the ICANN program, the FBI's and ACM Images National Review, ICE's Cybercrime Center, and U.S. Postal Inspection Service are the best way to underfund it. But why I ask that is our civil rights workers, I'm sorry, human rights workers, and they deserve our support. The price we pay for keeping it short, we measure the children lost. There are times in our line of work when you find yourself staring in the eyes of the children in these movies and apologize. We apologize because we can't find it. We can't rescue. There's not enough people or resources there. On behalf of those victims, I thank you for doing everything in your power to help us fight this human rights crisis. Thank you, Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the distinguished members of the committee. As the director of the Exploited Child Division at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, I welcome this opportunity to appear before you to discuss crimes against children on the Internet. The National Center draws on your concern for the safety of the most vulnerable members of our society, and thank you for bringing attention to the serious problem facing America's communities. The National Center is a not-for-profit corporation mandated by Congress and working in partnership with the Department of Justice as the National Resource Center and Clearinghouse on Missing and Exploited Children. One of our programs is the Cyber Tip Line that access the 911 of the Internet. It serves as the National Clearinghouse for investigative leads and tips regarding crimes against children on the Internet. Congress mandated that the National Center establish and operate the Cyber Tip Line in its Justice Department appropriations legislation for fiscal year 1998. The Cyber Tip Line operates in partnership with the FBI, with ICE, with the U.S. Postal Inspection Service, with the U.S. Secret Service, the Department of Justice's Child Exploitation Group Center Section, the Nationwide Internet Crimes Against Children Task Forces, as well as all state and local law enforcement agencies here in the United States. Since the Cyber Tip Line began operation, the National Center has received and processed more than 525,000 reports regarding child sexual exploitation, resulting in hundreds of arrests and prosecutions. These leads come from both the public as well as electronic service providers, which we call ESPs. They're mandated to report to the Cyber Tip Line any images of apparent child pornography under Section 13032, of the U.S. Code. Reports are prioritized, processed, and then submitted to the appropriate law enforcement agency by our analysts. The FBI, ICE, and the Postal Inspection Service have real-time access to the leads and all three agencies assigned agents and analysts to work on them. Rapid dissemination of cyber tip line reports is accomplished using virtual private network connections. ESPs, the electronic service providers that are registered with the cyber tip line, use a secure website to upload images of apparent child pornography directly onto our server, which we then encrypt. The VPN is also used to transmit these images and the cyber tip line reports to the National ICANN Task Forces, which also has secure encrypted connections into the cyber tip line. The majority of the cyber tip line leads are referred to the 46 federally funded ICANN Task Force agencies, one of the most effective initiatives in the fight against online child sexual victimization. It was Congress in 1997 that conceived the idea of creating specialized units to investigate these types of crimes. In the 10 years since then, the National ICANN program has become a model of successful federal oversight of state and local programs, which, though geographically diverse, are united by national standards with investigative policies and procedures. The National ICANN program complements the federal agency's efforts as they work seamlessly in the fight against online victimization. The technical analysis of a report that we would receive from electronic service provider begins with taking in whatever information that company provides to us, and then we try to match it to other online activity. Conducting online searches is one method we use to try to connect a real person to their online identity. We use both publicly available search tools as well as commercialized search tools that are often given to the National Center at no cost. These searches often turn up information valuable to law enforcement, including whether or not the offender has legitimate access to a child, such as a school bus driver. Law enforcement will want to move quickly in cases where a child could be in imminent danger. Using the information we gather from the cyber tip line, law enforcement serves the legal process, gathers evidence, and obtains probable cause for arrest of the perpetrator. In our experience, the child victims would have never told anyone about their abuse. The perpetrator would have remained anonymous but for the cyber tip line, and despite what should have been the obvious clues to the true nature of the offender. Who are the children that we see in these images every day? Of the identified offenders in a one-year period, 83% of them have images of children being sexually abused under the age of 12. 39% have images of children under the age of 6, while 19% of the offenders have images of children being sexually abused under the age of 3 years old. Because of our role as a clearinghouse for online crimes against children and the reputation we have earned while assisting law enforcement, our analysts see more child pornography than any law enforcement agency in the world. This benefits our child victim identification program, a joint project with our federal law enforcement partners and the ICAC task forces to identify children who are being actively abused, as well as assist with prosecution of these cases. At this point, we know that at least 1,200 child victims will have been rescued, and thankfully, I can report to you that the child that you are viewing here has been rescued by law enforcement. Today, we're working with leaders in the internet industry to explore improvements, new approaches, and better ways to attack the problem. NetNet urges the committee to take a serious look at the dangers threatening our children, moving decisively to provide law enforcement with the tools that they need to identify and prosecute those who victimize our children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Wentz. Jim Scott, welcome to the Forbes. Distinguished members, thank you for having us. I'm glad we're the executive director of the National Association of Protect Children, where grassroots organization is active in the states and Washington State. I'm going to talk about more just to be brief here. I'm going to focus on the one thing that this Congress is consistently doing year after year this year, and that is a frank assessment of the state of readiness of law enforcement at the federal state level. Let me begin by reviewing what we know about the magnitude of this crisis. First, we know that there are hundreds of thousands of individuals within the U.S. right now actively engaged in this crisis. Hundreds of thousands. The Department of Justice has testified before Congress to this. And as you've heard from major lawyers, this is a matter of fact. Second, we know that these individuals are responsible for hundreds of thousands of child victims in the United States. Everything we know about the rate of victimization and the number of victims tells us that if there are a half a million people out there, we're tracking the child pornography, and you're talking about hundreds of thousands of child victims. Third, we know that these hundreds of thousands of perpetrators are committing billions of crimes. That's important because the volume of crimes is the best indicator we have of what is essentially a market demand, a question mark. For more and more product that's going to be provided by the rape and torture of more children. The most important thing, perhaps, that we know is that we can prevent this. This is entirely unnecessary. Because of the innovative law enforcement techniques that every lawyer has talked about, and if there is a case team, we know where these guys are. And there's no reason in the world why this child should continue to suffer because of what we've done. The attack in this case is actually not being thoroughly investigated. According to the FBI, it was a 6.5-year period between FY 2001 and mid 2007. The number of suspects identified and arrested by the FBI for online child exploitation claims was 5,048. The ICAC program, comprised of 46 task forces nationwide, reports just over 2,000 arrests in FY 06. We don't have reliable numbers like our highest state postal, but they might be considered smaller. All of this, there is no fault of these heroes that are out there to front lines doing this work. That's a
Also, John Adler, the FBI's incident with his national initiative, based in Calverton, Texas, 32 state, including 13 agents. That previous congressional testimony of the FBI and Department of Justice have emphasized restricting the full-time deliverance. And I think it's important that this committee understands the very inadequate, grossly inadequate size of this unit in certain. The NSA reduced congressional appropriation last year was $10 million. That's less than half of what they gave to Jersey City, New Jersey, for housing and community development. And FYI, six of budget for the entire ICAC Task Force program, which is a tremendous success, was $14.5 million. After years of administration neglect and failing congressional scrutiny, the Department of Justice has finally increased that dollar to $1 million, but we're still talking about a quarter of one person arrested. Law enforcement also suffers from a critical lack of forensic resources at every level, in your states, and at the federal level, when you're attempting to get them to wait 8 months to deliver a drug on the list. How is this possible? How, in a country where you can't go a single night without hearing about sex offenders, or TV shows about sex offenders? How is it possible to have a flourishing criminal marketplace in children that builds up with the community? Let me take a stab at that and conclude with our insight into why this is going on today. In 1996, the World Wide Web really took off. That was the year that the public became aware of it. And so it's a World Wide Web. That's also the year that babies were exposed, which is a big piece of legislation. But at one point, the babies are, which imposed a form of citizen supervision on the sex offenders. That came in a sense of the whole paradigm. For how this country thinks about child sexual abuse. It became the way we talk about it, the way we legislate about it. And it was popular because it's enormous, it was cheaper, it was irresistible to be there, it was popular. As that decade wore on, we talked consistently about registered sex offenders, child pornography exploited. Children became a commodity, an underground economy. Law enforcement continued to fall farther and farther behind. Law enforcement was not given the personnel, the equipment, the training, forensic plans, or any other support they needed to come find these kids and rescue them. Year after year, we moved on to the new rhetoric. The administration taught them that refused to support law enforcement. Year after year, they refused to even shoot straight with Congress about what the resources really were and what they needed. It got so bad that by last year, Congressman Chatrooms from Texas practically begged the Department of Justice to tell them what they needed from Congress. It was badly useless. By the end of the 90s of the decade, America ended up with an enormous surplus of rhetoric about sex offenders and a severe deficit of resources to do anything about them. We were spending millions hunting for sex offenders who failed to register their addresses, while ignoring regions of new sex offenders whose locations we do not. We were doing the things that cost the least and sound the toughest, while neglecting the things that cost real money that could save the most lives. Now the 110th Congress has the opportunity to continue with the 109th Congress that this administration did not fight back, pay what it costs, disrupt this market, and go get this children. You have the opportunity to show America 50 state legislatures. A little less talk and a lot more action. You can launch the toughest offensive against child sexual predators this nation has ever seen. And it must be the largest child abuse prevention campaign in history. And I'm proud to say that millions of American taxpayers from all walks of life will be behind that 100%. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wentz. You were sorry.
And well, thanks, Chairman Scott, Ranking Member Forbes, and the distinguished members of this committee for the opportunity to be here before you today to discuss the issue of online child protection. Anyone strongly supports the efforts of this committee and shares the goal of protecting children's experience online and safeguarding online users from predators. My name is John Ryan, Chief Counsel at AOL, where I oversee our efforts to assist law enforcement to keep criminal activity off our networks. Prior to joining AOL, I was a prosecutor in New York, where I investigated and prosecuted numerous which has been used as a model for cooperation between law enforcement and industry in the prosecution of electronic crimes. The story that I believe needs to be told today is the extraordinary work that we and other online companies have done to protect children online. Those include technology and solutions that provide children with safe areas and provide parents with tools to guard and monitor their children's activities, provide law enforcement with tools and assistance needed to investigate and prosecute internet-related crimes, or educational efforts to empower parents and children, and our ongoing work with others in the internet community to develop best practices and solutions. For all these efforts make good business sense, but more importantly, for the right thing to do. A decade ago, AOL pioneered the concept of parental controls to give parents powerful tools to enable them to set and enforce safety rules for their children's online activities. With AOL's still industry-leading products, parents can now set time limits for online activity, decide whether their children can email an IA, and if so, with whom, choose the websites and products they can access, and even get a report of their child's online activities, essentially a report card of where they have been and what they have done. These amazing capabilities have been recognized in a recent landmark decision in the Copenhagen. The Federal District Court in Philadelphia recognized that AOL crowd controls on over 93% of sexually explicit websites and 87% from parents found it easy to use. Now, AOL has made their crowd controls free of charge even to non-AOL users. AOL also offers other tools, such as a visible and convenient notified AOL button for members to report unacceptable or illegal behavior to teams or trained professionals who work closely with law enforcement. Finally, AOL produces and provides alternative web programming for children and teens so that they can have a positive internet experience. Collectively, these are extraordinary tools provided by our industry parents to protect their children. In 1999, Congress passed important legislation that requires service providers to report apparent images of child pornography to the National Center. This legislation actually reflected a practice that AOL had undertaken several years prior, enabling AOL to begin immediate compliance. To improve reporting further, the industry developed a broader sound practices management that encourages the referral of offending images and other valuable information to NCMEC in order to ensure that law enforcement has sufficient basis for a quick follow-up. In 2006, AOL and other leading service providers submitted nearly 30,000 reports related to child pornography and endangerment. Those are 30,000 child pornography cases that likely would have gone unnoticed. We also responded effectively to law enforcement inquiries. This past August, Pennsylvania law enforcement told us they urgently needed to find the location of a child molester who was abusing two children and broadcasting video of the abuse in real time. Working with law enforcement, AOL was able to provide the police with the location and the police caught the molester in the act that rescued the children. AOL's efforts do not simply stop at reporting evidence of crimes. AOL has a team of highly trained and dedicated professionals, including former prosecutors, who insist on tens of thousands of cases per year. They have a 24-hour dedicated law enforcement hotline to respond to law enforcement requests on a timely basis. Since 1995, we also offer pretrial litigation support, as well as fact and expert witness testimony in criminal cases involving records obtained from AOL. The important message is, while there are ways to enhance these processes even further, the underlying frameworks for reporting crimes, preserving evidence, cooperating with law enforcement were strong and effective. The processes that Congress and industry put in place really did work. We also continue to innovate. AOL implemented extremely effective technologies to identify, detect, and remove child pornography images from any broad transmission within our network. In addition to the detection, we collect them and forward them along to the National Center, and then work with law enforcement for ultimate prosecution. We were the first provider to work online with the Amber Alert program, and we now use that same technology to alert campuses for safety issues after the tragedy at Virginia Tech. We also recently instituted with the National Center a dedicated area where they can set up a space since they have been designated as the Emergency Child Locator Center in light of the tragedy at Katrina. So our work is ongoing, and we look forward to working with this committee to develop further strategies.
Chairman Scott, Ranking Member Forbes, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today to talk about how we can all work together on the very important issue of child online safety. I'm pleased to tell you that in my 8 years at Yahoo, I've seen significant improvement in the user control tools, educational resources, and enforcement systems to protect children. Unfortunately, as you've heard today, despite these efforts, problems persist. It is essential that both industry and government fulfill their unique roles in promoting online safety. Yahoo's commitment to fostering a safe environment begins with our own products and services. Our approach focuses on four key areas. First, building safer online spaces. We offer a safe site for kids and tools such as safe search, parental controls, and privacy preferences that allow users to decide what information to share and with whom to communicate. Tools alone are not enough. We also educate users. This year, we launched Yahoo Safely, an educational site on the do's and don'ts of online safety. More recently, Yahoo Match joined with iSafe on a safety video for teens. Second, reporting inappropriate content. Yahoo encourages users to report violations through prominent report abuse links and works with partners such as the Internet Watch Foundation who report child abuse URLs. To promptly report child pornography to NCMEC, we invested in systems to forward the information needed for successful law enforcement referrals. Third, detecting and deterring child pornography. We have a multifaceted approach to mining technology, user and third-party reports, and human review. We also partner to develop new tools, including supporting a technology coalition to build better solutions. Partnerships are the fourth aspect of our strategy. Yahoo works with groups like iSafe and NCMEC to promote online safety. On Friday, Yahoo and the California Technology Assistance Project will host a summit on internet ethics and safety. Yahoo's partnership with law enforcement is a key element in our efforts. Our compliance team is available to law enforcement 24/7 for emergencies. We've created a guide for law enforcement outlining our procedures, and we regularly participate in training, including ICAP conferences. Recently, we partnered with state attorneys general to conduct training in Nebraska, New York, Texas, New Jersey, and Colorado. Yahoo is committed to protecting children, but there is more to be done. Critical functions such as prosecuting and sentencing offenders can only be performed by government. There are four areas where the public-private partnership can be enhanced by congressional action: safety education, law enforcement tools, government supervision of sex offenders, and resources. These are discussed at length in my written testimony, and I would like to highlight a few. The child pornography reporting statute should be revised to clarify the data NCMEC needs to refer reports to law enforcement. Providers should also be given immunity for transferring illegal images to NCMEC. After these improvements, this should become the single national standard to ensure coordination among federal, state, and local authorities. We also encourage the committee to ensure preservation requests are part of the referral process. Preservation authority is a powerful tool that helps ensure future availability of data. This targeted approach avoids many of the pitfalls associated with broader privacy. Thus, we support provisions in the Rescue Online Services Act, just introduced by Representatives Christopher Carney and Steve Shadid. Also, a bill introduced by Representative Nick Lamson would allow states to use critical investigative techniques in child exploitation cases. To address concerns about sex offenders, we recommend the committee give additional resources, training, and legal authority to those best equipped to determine how to minimize the risk: the judges who sentence offenders and the parole and probation officers who oversee them. This could be done by expanding guidance for judges on restricting internet use by offenders, and by providing monitoring tools and training to parole and probation officers. We are concerned that approaches that do not leverage law enforcement to set and enforce restrictions could have unintended consequences, including ensnaring innocent internet users. There are two final areas that support the legislative changes I've outlined: training and funding. There are several bills notable for making the necessary investments to protect children. Bills introduced by Representative Debbie Wasserman Schultz and Representative Bobby Scott both include funds for law enforcement training. A bill introduced by Ranking Member Lamar Smith has resources for innocent images, and a bill introduced by Representatives Shabbat and Lampson has funds for ICACs. helpful to see the strategic funding as well as appropriations for the Agriculture Act. Young is pleased to be among the witnesses at this hearing, taking decisive action to fight child exploitation. We look forward to working with the Committee on Legislation. Young can eagerly support to advance this goal. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for all of our witnesses. Questions, they recognize themselves. First, the question is for 5 minutes. First, just very briefly, Mr. Ryan, in his backup, having a difficult time complying with the laws, and that required a report images. Does any logistical problem with that?
With respect to ILO, Madam Chairman Scott, that's been our practice for over 7 years, and prior to the legislation, we were doing that on a voluntary basis. So we are very comfortable with that practice. We do qualify on this committee for the opportunity to clarify the grant, the immunity, and the transmission of those images. So it minimizes any open issues that may be raised. Clearly, the Department of Justice understands and endorses the practice. But we're giving, I think, greater assurance to those ISPs who still may be on the sidelines to get them to pony up and engage in the process of doing
and putting the data for executive documents for any identity that could occur because of the transmission violation of private citizens.
That's correct, because we as private citizens do not have any, non-legislative ability to possess those images during the time which they are conveyed to the government or to law enforcement.
I'd just like to add that the current reporting statute does not specify that the image should be part of the report, and we think that both clarity as to what should go into a report to NCMEC, saying that it should include the image, as well as then making sure that the appropriate immunities are in place for the transfer of the image, would greatly improve the quality of the reports that NCMEC receives.
Violation of people's privacy, that you can take somebody's privacy that wasn't a threat, and they were to an interview and expose their privacy or something like that. That's not your mind that from that. When you're talking about immunity, because you, during that period of time, that you have possession of the material. Mr. Morris indicated that we don't have the resources. Mr. Weeks has indicated that the number of prosecutions compared to the number of cases we know about. Somewhat modest. There was some estimate indicating hundreds of thousands of leads and only 3 to 4 cases. So, are there any cases? Any possible investigations? I thought you said hundreds of thousands of possible investigations.
Yes, I didn't say that. We have approximately 2,600 current cases.
Okay. How much more money would you need to pursue the cases that Mr. Weeks and Mr. Morris have indicated? Cases where you have higher leads and extra resources. Because of lack of resources, you can't pursue them.
That would be an answer you'd have to come back to the committee with, and it would be hard to answer now. It's tantamount in some respects to trying to catch everybody going 58 miles an hour to 55 miles an hour speed. So the number of people out there engaged in this activity is absolutely staggering. And so at this moment in time, I wouldn't be able to give you a figure that would allow us to cover a lot of the people out there that is in this kind of activity.
I suspect that you might have, going 58 across the kind of damage that's been caused here. And I think you might get the resources to catch everybody from 58.
I agree, I certainly didn't mean to compare the consequences of those two acts.
So if you could give us some resource numbers, Mr. Wise, what kind of numbers you should have in the hearing in terms of resources?
We're bringing in roughly 35 to 40 figures that we identify in our
7 and taken by 7. We can never write out 7 to 10 cases a month. If we triple that by then, we may be able to get a style of trying to keep up with just what's coming in, not the growth. We're seeing it escalate each month. So at the current state, I think triple the average would be
almost zero.
Thank you. website, live government-sponsored network and program, other judges and child community and sexual cases, and twice the rate for other crimes in the last 2 years since the sentencing guidelines became advisory on the Supreme Court in the U.S. Department of Child Development, and minus 29%, 26% minus accelerated, 26%, so basically,
line of defense for these children as their parents, but
I really believe the first line of defense for children is themselves and being knowledgeable about what to do if they're online and they're getting a proper contact or messages that make them uncomfortable, and I know that there are a number of programs that are being forced trying to teach children about online safety, and that perhaps that aspect of it doesn't get a lot of attention, although really it should, because children need to be educated about what to look for when they're online. Mr. Weeks, I'm fully aware of the fact that there's a lack of resources that have been dedicated towards prosecuting these online predators, and that seems to be an overriding theme among all of the panelists that really, if Congress were serious about this, we would stop spewing rhetoric and do things that will be taken into account the real cost and that are really going to be effective. We have to commend you for being tough and speaking the truth. I mean, speaking truth to power is often the first thing that needs to happen in changing attitudes. And unfortunately, oftentimes the easy or least costly solutions are what people grasp for, so that they can say, well, we've done something about this. You did mention, though, in addition to needing more resources and funding for enforcement, that there are perhaps other things that Congress can do as well to help prosecute these predators. Could you just mention, in as much time as is left, some of those things that Congress can do?
Well, I think there's a number of bills suggested today that were very good and would help in enforcement and help us do this. I would add one thing that I think would have a tremendous impact, and that's just simply accountability. I think that in communities smaller and larger across the country, nobody, in terms of prosecutors, is not accountable. We understand the concept of holding judges accountable. We know what we're saying. We say a judge who sits at the bench and looks at child pornography is upset and they think it's probation. But it's not the judges 99% of the time that make those decisions. It's the prosecutors. Most of these cases never do. Maybe they get burned before they get the judge. So, accountability in terms of some self-taught section. If this country, if our citizens knew who took this seriously and didn't, I think people would get chance to be in the
Thank you. My time has expired. And I will recognize the gentleman from Florida for 5 minutes of questions.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. For me, the bottom line is that online child predators must be captured and prosecuted. Because we're limited to 5 minutes, I want to limit my questions to the narrow issue of women. It's a behavior that occurs when internet child predators lie about their age to entice their victims. For example, earlier today, the Bishop Prosecutor testified, quote, I chatted for months with Christine, a beautiful, red-haired 14-year-old girl who just understood me all too well. Christine was really a middle-aged, perfect, and gentle. Somehow, in this process, this brilliant of me, it had changed me and destroyed my ability to raise a close quote. A few months ago, the Florida legislature passed the cyber crimes against children act and became the highest state in the nation, with a law specifically targeted for 49 out of 50 states have no such law in the books, and the federal government has no such law in the books. Mr. Waters, what is your experience in dealing with this behavior that we're hearing about public women?
Thank you, sir. We do get a lot of reactive calls when we have children and we have our staff who have been contacted by individuals. Frequently, we have people coming up with chargeable actions if the individuals have not yet started specifically addressing the sexual activity they're looking for with the child.
Is it a common phenomenon for these online child predators to misrepresent their age in order to give young teenagers a false sense of security?
It is.
Can you see that or whatever?
We do.
And let me ask you, Ms. Collins, your National Center collects the Wi-Fi data. Can you see this as a problem?
Absolutely. The problem with online porn, we also accept reports of enticement. In fact, we've had a 300%, approximately 300% increase in just the last year of reports coming into the public regarding enticements. It is a big problem that children, boys and girls in their teen years are especially vulnerable, particularly girls between the ages of 13 and 15. The offenders who are targeting them know exactly what they need to do in order to work their way into the child's life, much like they did with Alicia. We do see them being deceptive about their age, certainly about their motives, but also the unfortunate reality is sometimes they're not actually lying about their age, and they're simply playing upon the emotional vulnerability of the child and trying to work their way in that way.
Mr. Mason, you're with the FBI, and you see this issue of grooming taking place with the child predators lying about their age. Right there. The victims feel more comfortable when they're more information. This is the day. What is it about this behavior that makes child predators think that they need to lie about their age? Or why is it that it comes from their investigative point of view? Well, they lie about themselves and they lie about the victim. And it's just a kind of factor that they can have with the victim. So there's so many things that as a poor man that they're trying to speak to. And unfortunately, as Mr. Wex said, it's sometimes at the beginning stage of your there's not much in the way that you can do with somebody who's running themselves out to that 16-year-old who happens to be a 27-year-old. What you grab after is a mom that's making that a crime to misrepresent their age, it would make it easier then to prosecute them and gather information from the perpetrators. I would agree with that. In the Federal Department of Justice, Mr. Rothenberg, do you have any opinion on that, whether that would make it easier to do the investigation and prosecution if there was a law in the books making it a crime to engage in a misrepresentation of an age to a woman? I think it's probably something we're having to look at. Right now, that line is in front of me, and it doesn't look like an expression of opinion, but we're happy to run through on that and take a look at that and learn about the process. But thank you, Ms. Collins, and it's very small, as we've got a report in office to catch child predators that are lined up by County General and he cited some statistics from their organization, National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. He said they have 77 million kids who use the internet daily, and one out of seven kids between the ages of 10 and 17 are sexually solicited by online. So it's correct.
That is the newest data that we have, that one in seven children have been sexually solicited in the last year.
Is that, where's that trend? Is that the one that we've seen?
Actually, the original research was conducted in 2001, and at that time, the number was 1 in 5 children admitted that they had been sexually solicited online. The good news is now it's saying 1 in 7. We're hoping that that may have something to do with the prevention work that's been done by countless agencies. The unfortunate reality, though, is even though the number appears to have been going up in terms of the solicitations, the aggressive solicitations have not changed at all. That would be those solicitors who are trying to reach a child by mail, by phone, or in person, and those have held steady since 5 years earlier, as well as the unfortunate fact that many of these children, more than half of them, never tell an adult or trusted adult when this happens to them. So those are the areas I think we can need to continue working on.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My time is expired.
I think the gentleman for his questions. I would now like to recognize the gentleman from the floor on this was recess for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One of my questions, I want to point out again for Mr. Mason. Mr. Mason, Arnold Bell is the chief of the Innocent Images Unit. Can you tell me why he isn't here today to testify?
He is here in the Senate earlier, but I was asked to be the testifier.
I believe Mr. Bell was actually invited to be the testifier. Was there a substitution made internally in the Justice Department?
Not in the Justice Department, but I did. But I don't know why I was there. The notification that I was not the testifier here today.
Mr. Bell is the person with the most in-depth knowledge about the FBI and his name is unit, isn't he?
That's correct.
I was personally disappointed that he was not sitting here at the table because you were obviously one person with the most in-depth knowledge to be the one that answers the questions. Can you get back to us as to why this was made? Because I know that we can't find anyone to get on the issue.
Thank you.
Who's James Finch?
He is an assistant director of our cyber division.
You're aware, aren't you, that Senator Biden wrote a letter to FBI Director Robert Mueller asking him specifically to take questions about the FBI's innocent images unit, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
And Mr. Finch responded to Senator Biden, we've seen the letter.
I don't recall seeing the letter, but I know he did respond to the letter.
So the number of agents actually has shrunk since Congressman Barton's was the chair of the Commerce Committee. Since his hearings last year, the number of investigators is actually less this year than it was last year, The total budget for the NSA Agents Program is about $30 million, is that right?
No, ma'am.
What is the
It's not $30 million. If you're talking about appropriated money, it's around. It's closer to $6 million.
I think the total funds is $30 million.
I'm not sure what you're making reference to in terms of total funds.
Well, I'm making reference to, as Mr. Finch also stated, it's not the same amount, but approximately $3.8 million was transferred from NSA Agents to IC3, which is the Internet Crimes Complaint Center. And what is IC3?
IC3 is a location we have in West Virginia where we collect internet complaints and internet complaints. It's a place to aggregate it because the average internet fraud amounts to about $75. So we're looking for a way to aggregate all of those complaints to find out when, in fact, we have a problem.
They investigate fraud and white-collar crime, correct?
That's correct.
Why is so much of it estimated as money being sent to an agency that has nothing to do with child protection?
Well, in fact, over 1,000 complaints last year came into IC3 from the Internet Crime Complaint Center.
The average child protection complaints? Child protection complaints came into IC3?
No, complaints of suspected child molestation. And so the fact of the matter is the average American doesn't understand necessarily that it's for the white collar crime only. They only know it's an Internet Crime Complaint Center, and they get calls of all natures.
The majority of the resources should be with the NSA Agents Program and not diverted to an agency that is dedicated to white collar crime and internet crime. Wouldn't you agree?
That might have been really close to IC3. With the IC3 on the edge where some of the agents that are split between the two, we see that as a force multiplier, so we do not see it as a diversion away from crimes against children, but rather as yet another type of force multiplier that helps us to identify even more perpetrators of crimes against children.
You're aware that we're investigating less than 2% of the activity?
I am.
Particularly because you compare the activity to speakers and crime
observing. It only has a scope issue, right? And relative to the rights.
I think it was an unfortunate analogy that you acknowledged. Has the department, your division, or any deputy in the Department of Justice asked for more money to pay the president's budget request to come back to spend the fund?
Well, we may have not asked for more money, but we had indicated in 2008 that none of the money for NSA Agents will be diverted to new hires.
But that's comforting. That would be good if the Department of Justice would focus their priorities on making sure that we up the percentage of crimes that you can against children that we can investigate beyond 10%.
If there is sufficient interest of that, I would like to have additional 5 minutes for questions. Is there something else you want
to add? Thank you. I don't need 5 minutes, but I would like to ask Mr. Weeks one question.
Without objection, the gentleman will be carrying 2 additional minutes.
Thank you, Chair Justin. Thank you very much. Mr. Weeks, you talked about a need for accountability. How would a special counsel at the Department of Justice that will be dedicated to coordinating all of the activity do what you were describing in terms of achieving that accountability? This would be a special counsel at the Department of Justice to child exploitation.
Congressman, my personal opinion is when we write the special counsel, we come to decide if there's any strong desire we need that. There are so many efforts going on right now. Within the Department of Justice and outside the Department of Justice, just within the Department of Justice, you've got the ICAP program, you've got the FBI, you've got CIs, the Child Exploitation Center section, you've got Project Safe Childhood, the U.S. Child Program. There's an urgent for coordination, planning, and with that, we're probably going to bring some elimination of duplicated efforts. I don't think anybody up here would believe for a second that we have to worry right now about waste or lack of efficiency, because
did exactly what you've been coming for, which is to refocus itself and say, and do this in a deliberate, efficient way.
It's interesting that we talk about accountability. We have here in Louisiana, we found out that less than 12% of people arrested actually ever went to jail. Part of that was judges, and part of it was prosecutors. But the difference, Mr. Winston pointed out, is that we have judges that have a record there that you can look at, transcript, and then you can compare the standards to the record. When you deal with prosecutors, a lot of things that don't have a record, you can't disclose what the witnesses were willing to testify, what they don't have an intro requirement, what the victims were concerned about going to trial, what the prosecutors had to take into play. Mr. Rayburn, we know that the Justice Department's proposed crackdown included a provision to create a mandatory minimum for possession of child pornography. Can you explain to us what a mandatory minimum penalty is?
This answer, because we believe, and I've seen in the attitude of a number of judges, that the child porn possession is located in the United States as it should be. And as I said, a lot of witnesses have said that the demand for child pornography is what drives these crimes against children. And especially in urban areas, in fact, even the young man in the older mission testified earlier today, so he had commented that the man who kidnapped her took photos and shared them with his friends. Obviously, most people who participated in the victimization were not throwing in the end. So to speak, looking at their phones. And we do have a problem, as my testimony states, under the site of one quarter of our child pornography offenses. The guidelines, the judges are not following the guidelines that would apply to these offenders that possess child pornography. And we believe that by establishing it to a mandatory minimum, we will be establishing it as a form that anybody who possesses child pornography will go to jail for 2 years. And we believe that that will send a signal to the judges, first of all, but also send a signal to express Congressman's opinion about the severity of the crime. And it may be useful for our prosecutors to have, just to give you some examples. There have been cases where we have in Chicago, data, no matter how long it's kept, these are real-time cases. It's
resources you need to get the job done.
Thank you. Approximately 40% of the reports we receive each week actually come from the electronic service providers. Law enforcement really loves the reports that we get from companies such as AOL, Yahoo, and so forth. And the companies have been very good about complying with the federal law mandate that they report child pornography. Unfortunately, they use for them in order for them to make a report to the cyber supply, they need to register with us so we know where the company is. There is no mandate that companies actually register with us. The contents of reports, when we have a new ISP calling, actually, I have staff right now in San Jose, California. Today, registering new ISPs at a conference out there, we've registered about 18 yesterday alone. We have to convince them of what they should be reporting. We have to kind of call upon their good nature and try to do the right thing in order to get the appropriate content from them. Companies such as Yahoo and AOL have been wonderful, but we've been working with them for many years. It would be very useful to have established content of reports that would be provided within a cyber tip line, as well as some overarching maintenance of records and retention that law enforcement, unfortunately, we're making hundreds of referrals every week. They are not able to get to these reports within a few days. So we ask that possibly the electronic service providers have more consistency and how long they maintain this data to allow law enforcement the opportunity to provide them with the legal process that they need.
Mr. Keller is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Let me go back to you, Ms. Collins. On behalf of the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, if there are parents and teachers, as well as teenagers, watching your testimony today, do you have any tips or proactive steps to protect against child predators that you can direct them to? Maybe a WhatsApp link or something like that. These are the 5 things that your parent or teacher should know.
I think that's an excellent question, and I think that that goes to something that you stated earlier, that about a child, whether it be the child is the first or the last line of defense for themselves. I think that there are remarkable programs out there of online safety. We used to have many of these tips listed on our website at cybertipline.com. But we really need to be able to enable it to empower these children to be able to recognize the warning signs. And I think that it's also important for parents when they hear the topic of internet creation to be able to keep some perspective of it, that not every child is at equal risk of being approached by a predator. There are specific activities that raise a child's likelihood of encountering a bad person, that may be chatting with people that they don't know online, talking about sexually explicit topics, sending photographs of themselves online. All of these will raise the risk of a child of finding somebody who wants to perpetrate against them.
And those and other tips can be found on the cyber@tripline.com.
Yes, and I would also like to recommend that adults, parents, and guardians go to our website, which is netsmarts411.org. They can ask any question that they wish, and our analysts will respond in a very clear-cut in English, non-technological answer of what it is, whether they want to know how to delete a MySpace page, how do I make my child's social networking page private, how can I see what websites my child has gone to. They can get the answers by going to netsmarts411.org.
Thank you. My next question, I'm going to start with you, and that is the issue of recidivism. For those listening, if that's a website, people who get on the ground again, do you have any statistics when it comes to child sex crimes, like child pornography, online child predators, child molesters, what the recidivism rate is?
I do not actually have those numbers for you. I'm not sure whether my law enforcement colleagues here would.
If you saw if anybody has any recidivism statistics, then you raise your hand or call on you. Yes, sir, Mr. Mix. Since you have this problem, like I don't know if you can understand the number because I got it with my brother Hobbs. The reason this is a significant question with Rob Institute for prevention and enforcement, and if you were talking about a kid who's engaged in shoplifting or vandalism, I would totally agree with that. I think some of these people can't be fixed, frankly. And I think a lot of people like to see how they're waiting for the
concern for it, and I said that part of the journey when I say that after that time is over, we'll still keep on saying that for me, thank God we do, because I can't do it again. That's why this issue of recidivism is really kind of looking at some of these things, and just missed it, and I'm going to fix it with the end. And if I'm not really able to do it again,
we also priced the federal version of the Human Rights Act, and had a bunch of all black last year as well. I'm hopeful that people are strongly supportive of it, and like good federal work from Florida. I'm really hopeful that other states will take the urging that Congress made and pass it back. And I would like to also confine the votes.
I think the general lady and I would be extremely happy to have the application. I will get the votes. Thank you.
Last year, for instance, we received about 76,000 leads through the cyber tip line. I do not have the number. I have that in my office. I can submit that to you as soon as we get that. But the vast majority of the leads that we do send out to local, state, and federal law enforcement, I would say approximately 70-75% are going to the ICAT task force.
So is it thousands?
Absolutely. So absolutely.
And how many leads, Mr. Wallace, does the ICAT data network send out to the individual ICAT system?
Is what's coming in from the public. It could be a parent who said that they found that their child is communicating with a stranger online. It could be a second-hand catch or child back online. Flint, Mr. Agent Waters, can correct me if I'm wrong, but primarily the ICAT data network is providing information out to law enforcement regarding individuals using peer-to-peer technology to trade images and videos of child pornography.
So, Mr. Waters, did you want to answer? As I read it, what's the primary description? Why they're doing it? Just like, some of which have categorized drug levels. Not only do we see who's trading, but we see the volume and the time frame that they're trading, the level of cyber security against the child. It's like they can select the best image. But the video process is just more formalized and scientific as opposed to more informal. Well, it's just state in the sense that it tells me in a way we're going to be looking at the data each day. We don't really look. The cyber tech line is receiving information from all types of folks who come across this material, so it makes a gap with what they're.
It really does run the gamut, and our analysts have added a tremendous. We have over 20 analysts in our cyber tip line who provide a tremendous amount of value before we refer those leads out to law enforcement. Because we get so many leads from the ISPs or the long-term service providers that provide us with the images, we need to rely very closely on our relationship with the ICAT task forces because we're not a law enforcement agency that can mail CDs or child pornography. So we allow law enforcement the secure, encrypted access into our system. Of the internet for the commission of sex crimes against children is one of manifest importance for every American, and it's a difficult problem for which there is not one easy solution. Nonetheless, I want to commend all our witnesses for their commitment to addressing this problem. We heard some very good ideas today, and hopefully we'll give Congress guidance as we proceed to move forward and try to tackle this very difficult issue.
Without objection, members will have 5 legislative days to submit any additional written questions for our panelists, which we look forward to you, and ask that you answer as promptly as you can so that they can be made part of the record. And without objection, the record will remain open for 5 legislative days for the submission of any other additional materials. And with that, this hearing is adjourned.